Hello everyone, welcome to lesson 29 of our GoLang course. In the previous lesson, we discussed the conditional statements in Go. We covered the if statement and also saw the if scoped variables where we talked a bit about code blocks. In this lesson, we will cover code blocks in detail. So let's get started. In Go, you can create variables within a program structure at different places. This means you can define variables at various points in your code, such as inside functions, loops, or even at the top level of a file, which is also called the package scope. These levels are known as code blocks or simply blocks. Blocks are used to group together multiple statements. Blocks can be found within functions, loops, conditionals, and other control structures. They help define the scope of a variable and the control flow of the execution. An interesting point to note for blocks is that variables defined in an outer block are accessible within the inner blocks, but reverse is not true. This means that if you define a variable in an outer block, it can be used in the inner block. However, a variable defined in the inner block is not accessible outside the block it is defined. In Go, you use curly braces to define a code block. This is true for function, loops, conditionals, and other control structures. It helps delineate the beginning and end of a block of code. Let's look at an example now. In our example here, variable A is a package level variable. Variable A will be accessible to you throughout the package. That is, if you create a different file in the same package or multiple function inside the same file, which is inside the package, the variable A will be accessible everywhere since it is package scoped. Inside the main function, we have B, which is a function level variable scope to the function main. That is, it cannot be accessed outside the main function. So here the block starts from here for the main function and ends here. B, which we define inside the block, cannot be accessed outside the block. Then we have C, which is a block scoped variable. Here we created a separate block inside the main function with curly braces. So this is the block that we created just for demonstration purposes. And we declared a variable C that has a value of 30. Inside the block, the outer block variables that are A and B should be accessible along with C, which is inside this block. But outside this block, C will not be accessible since it is scoped to this block only. On the other hand, A and B can be accessed here since A is in the outer block of the main function and B is within the scope of the main function. So outer block variables can be accessed inside the inner block, but inner block variables cannot be accessed outside the outer block. For visual representation of blocks, we have an illustration here. As you can see, the outermost block is the universal block or the global block where the language functions like len, gap exist. One level below is the package block. We will learn more about packages in a future lesson. For now, just remember that packages are a collection of similar functions, structs, variables, etc. Packages can have multiple files. Inside the package block is the file block. The imports that you write to import other packages into your file is scoped to that file only. If you have multiple files in the package, you would need to import the package you want to use for each file separately. Under the file block is the function block. You have already seen the main function, which is the entry point of a Go program, and we started with curly braces. So that's the scope of a function. Everything within those curly braces is inside the function block. We will study function in depth in a future lesson. At the lowest level or the innermost level are the code blocks we create with curly braces. So for loops or if statements, or as we saw in the previous example, where we just created a block with curly braces inside the main function. You can create as many blocks of code as you like inside an existing code block, but it does not really have a practical use. Let us now look at shadowing of variables. Shadowing happens when you create a variable with the same name in the inner code block as the one that already exists in the outer code block. This creates a new variable with the same name as the existing one, but within a narrower scope, since you are creating it inside the inner code block. When there is shadowing, the inner variable takes precedence over the outer variable. This means that references to the variable inside the inner block will refer to the newly shadowed variable. Shadowing can make code harder to understand because it introduces ambiguity. It can lead to confusion about which variable is being referenced, especially in a larger and more complex code bases. It is generally considered a good practice to avoid shadowing unless it's absolutely necessary for a specific reason. For instance, if you need to reassign a variable for a specific calculation or operation within a smaller scope, it might be more readable to choose a different variable name rather than shadowing. There are linting tools available that will help you prevent shadowing of variables. A very popular Go linting tool is GoLang CI-lint. We will dedicate a separate lesson for linting and formatting in which we will discuss GoLang CI-lint. Here, we have an example of shadowing. In the main function, we have declared a variable name x with value 10. Next, we have the if code block starting with the curly braces. Please note that the condition of the if check is always true. So, this code block will be always executed. We are just using it to demonstrate the shadowing of variables with it. Inside the if block, we have again declared a variable x and assigned it a value of 10. And inside the if block, if you try to print the value of x with fmt println, you will see that 20 is printed. That is because the inner x is shadowing the outer x. But the rule of code block still applies. That is, if you try to access x outside the if code block, you will get the value 10 printed, because in the outer code block, x is available with value of 10, which is inner x inside the if block is not available outside the block. Now, let us look at some code examples of blocks and shadowing. Here in the code example, I have package main, inside which I have declared a variable a with value 10. And inside the main function, I first print the value of a, then I create a synthetic block with just curly braces. Again, inside the block, we initialize another variable with the same name, a, which will shadow the package level variable. We will run the program and see what happens. But first, let us look at another file that I have declared in the same package. If you notice, this file too has package main, which tells that this file is part of package main. Inside it, I have imported fmt. As we discussed, the imports are scoped to the file itself. So, even though I am using fmt here in the same package, but since it's a different file, I have to import it again. Now, if you look, a is a package level variable, which means it should be available in util.go as well, since they both reside in same package. Don't worry if you are confused, we will learn about packages more in the future lesson. For now, just know that since a is a package level variable, we can access it in any file inside the package like we did here, where we are doing fmt println a, and that will work. Now, in our main.go, let's see what happens when we run the program. The first println statement should print value 10, and the next one, since we have shadowed the variable a, should print the value of 15. Let's run our program and see the output. As you can see, as we predicted, the first value printed to the console is 10, and the next value printed to the console is 15. Since the inner block variable a took the precedence over the package level variable a. What happens if I try to print the same statement outside the block that we created with curly braces? Let's just copy this and put it right here. Again, since this is outside the block, we should get the value of a to be 10, since the inner a variable is not accessible outside the block or outside the curly braces it is defined in. Let's run our program and see the output. As you can see, we get printed 10, 15, and 10, which is correct, since here we access the packet level variable a. Inside the block, we created a new variable which shadows the value of packet level variable a, and we printed it, which gives us 15. But since inner a is not accessible outside the code block or the curly braces, when we did fmt println on line 17, we got 10 again. So this was a short example how there are different level of code blocks and how shadowing can add a lot of confusion to your code, because at this point you may expect the value to be printed 15, but since it's not accessible outside this code, you will get 10 printed. Since this program is short, we can predict how this works. But in longer code bases where there are multiple lines of code, it can be hard to deal with shadowing. So it's better to name the inner variables with a different name. In this lesson, first we learned about code blocks and what they are and how there are different code blocks in Go. We also learned if two variables of the same name exist at a different level or different code blocks, the variable in the innermost code block will take precedence over the outer code block variable. We also saw an example of shadowing and how it can create confusion. So, for better code clarity, we should avoid using it. That's it for the lesson. If you have any questions, please post a comment under the video or reach out to our Discord server. I will post the link to the same in the video description. I hope you enjoyed the lesson. I will see you in the next lesson. Happy coding!